May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to thee, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Please be seated. The story is really a very simple story, but we like to embellish stories, and we like the season to stretch very far into October these days. But those of us who've been here for Advent have been listening to some stories about preparing the way for the Lord. John the Baptist, we hear a lot about in Advent. And one of the ironies of this beautiful story written by Luke 2,000 years ago is that they did not prepare the way for Jesus. When Mary and Joseph got to Bethlehem, they knocked on doors, they tried to find family who would let them in, but it had been many generations since that family had had anybody they knew in Bethlehem. Many generations. And as we know, at the beginning of the story, there was no room for them at the inn. They were migrants, and they had nowhere to go. So as the story says, they found a place where there was a manger. Now we assume a lot of things. It never says stable. The story never says stable. It could have been a cave. In Bethlehem, there are caves where shepherds did and still do house their sheep for the night. So that's a possibility. But we embellish things. So we have a stable, a beautiful stable that Mary Bosher finished up with her husband and son. So we thank Mary for doing that. It's beautiful. And the children at the first service brought up all of the participants in this story. And the beautiful figures that were carved in Haiti are in their places. Except for the wise men. They're over there in the window. They're still traveling. They're in Iran right now. Give them time. So back to the story, I think we are supposed to take the point that after all of John the Baptist's work, he was a baby, by the way, at the time that Jesus was born, so he really couldn't prepare the way yet. But we are supposed to be ready when Jesus comes, right? And we get ready by saying prayers, by looking at your own story and seeing where God has worked in your own lives, and listening to other people tell their stories, which we do a lot in this tradition. We like to tell stories. So they have this baby, and they lay it in the manger. And before they lay it in the manger, Mary does something very particular to the baby, and the angel reports this. So this must be important, because it's the two times we hear it. Tonight we just heard it once. The angel says, "You will know, you will find this child who is the Messiah, the Savior, the Lord, who we have been expecting. You will find this child wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger." So they have to figure out, lying in a manger. Now, most people don't have a manger in their hotel room and probably not in their living room. So they probably go looking in caves, yes, and barns for this child wrapped in swaddling clothes. What does the wrapping of this baby symbolize? There's two times that Jesus gets wrapped. He gets wrapped because it's really comforting for a baby to be wrapped up tight like a little baby burrito. And they like being snug, so this is very likely what happened with Jesus. And after he dies on the cross, the women come with spices and they anoint his body and wrap it in cloths, very like swaddling cloths. So we are, those of us who are listening to this story, we're not naive, we know the end of this story. I hope. We know the end of this story, and we know that we're supposed to project all that onto this beautiful little scene, and think how ironic it was 2,000 years ago that nobody knew he was coming when they were supposed to know he was coming. They were looking for a Messiah, but they weren't looking for someone coming to such a lowly couple from the outback, from Galilee, from Nazareth. It's a nothing town. They weren't looking there. And they weren't looking at an unwed mother to be the mother of this child. So there was no room for them in the inn. Nobody knew who they were. Mary did know. This angel came to her. First, that angel came to Zechariah, the father of John the Baptist. So this is not the first time we've seen this angel. This angel has been very busy. First to Zechariah, then to Elizabeth, and then to Mary, preparing all of them for this child that is coming. And Mary holds all these things in her heart, and she doesn't tell anyone. And she doesn't say, "What do you mean you don't have a room for me? I'm the mother of the Lord." Can you even imagine that? No. Mary holds these things in her heart, and thank God for that. So we are supposed to see the irony, because today, are we any more prepared for Jesus to come? Will we be looking in the migrants to see if that's where our Lord is coming? Because that's where our Lord probably will be. Shepherds are about as despised today in the Holy Land as they were in those days. And they're not very popular. They migrate around, they're riffraff, they smell bad, they have big tents and large smelling camels. So we won't be looking there for the Lord our God to come. And what a wonderful way for him to come, to sneak in like that and surprise us. And that is the main message that we get from the story, is that we will be surprised by the good news, because that's what God does. And that's how God works in all of our lives. Where we least expect it, joy will pop out. And where we think we have things figured out and are judging others, there we will be surprised, and somebody beautiful will emerge in a place you never expected to find someone beautiful. God does this a lot. And if you look at the Bible, there's story after story of surprises. So, let's see what the angels did. The angels were terrified of, not the angels, the shepherds were terrified of the angels. I got that switched around. Straighten me out. The angels are very scary. Full of light, full of thunder, no harps, they brought no harps. And they have this stupendous news, and there's bright light, so bright that it makes you want to hide your eyes. And they tell them to go find this child who is the Lord, their God, their Savior. And what do the shepherds do? They go quickly. So this is the message that Luke tells again and again and again in his gospel. If you hear the good news, don't let any moss gather under your feet. You skedaddle and go where they tell you to go. If you're supposed to spread the good news with, people that are out there, then that's what you're supposed to do. These shepherds were our first evangelists. They came and they told this good news to the most unexpected people. This tall man, I'm thinking, and this sweet, young, teenage mother. They didn't know what the angel had said. So they told Mary and Joseph the good news. Did you know that? They did that, and then they went out and told everybody else, which is a message for us. Some of us are good evangelists. We love to tell stories, and we like to talk about our faith. Some of us Episcopalians are not so good at that, but we're getting better, right? Yes. And some of us are more like Mary. And if you're like Mary, take heart. Mary has a very important role to play. She also has many sorrows. So if you think you're like Mary, watch out. Many sorrows will come your way. But Mary holds these things in her heart because she needs a very big heart for what's going to happen. Which, when you think about it, we all need. We all need that big heart. This world needs that big heart. So hold this hurting world in your big heart and evangelize, evangelize, evangelize that we are not about oppression. We are not about judging others or being better than, are we? We're looking in unlikely places for the Lord our God to come. Right? And we're going to get